The Torah gives us the principles in terms of what is a kosher animal and what is not. So when it comes to a behemoth, an animal, we know the animal has to chew its cud and have split hooves. Or in terms of a fish, it needs fins and scales. So as well, the Torah tells us, in addition to the prohibition of eating animals and fish, there's also a prohibition of eating bugs. Sheretz, Hashoretz, Alaretz, different swarmy bugs. And it's a big Kiddush HaTorah, because bugs aren't really roi l'achila, really aren't fit for consumption. I mean, if a general rule, something is not fit for consumption, so even if it's prohibited, it's usually only the drabanan. It's only a rabbinical prohibition. However, bugs, even though they're not roi l'achila, not fit for consumption, nevertheless, the Chiddush HaTorah is, bugs are prohibited to eat, even min HaTorah. And the truth be told, we probably all consume bugs every day. It's a biblical prohibition to consume bugs. However, the Isser in the Torah is only visible bugs, something which is nearer my eye, and something we could tell by looking at. That's so tiny and they just come in the air, we swallow them, or they're in our foods, and we can't even see them. So the Isser to eat bugs is a bug that you could see. And in fact, this isn't limited to the prohibition of bugs, but in general, we go by what one would see without using any special instruments, like a microscope or different lenses. In fact, it's a famous tshuva from Rav Moshe, when he discusses how to determine whether, we know to determine whether a woman is anida or not, she has to see if she sees red. So let's say it's a tiny spot, you really can't tell if it's red, but you need a microscope, or you need some type of instrument to see whether it's red. So Rav Moshe says, no, you're not mechuyev to. Whatever you can see with your naked eye, if I can't tell it's red, if the only way I can tell red is through an instrument, I don't have to be concerned. It has to be something where you can see, a human being can see themselves. And similarly, Rav Schechter always says over a story that someone came to him and asked him if his tefillin was square. You know, and part of the lach of tefillin has to be scared, so he did a little measurement. He said, yeah, the tefillin's fine. So this person happened to be a dentist, and he said he works with fillings and tiny squares all day, and he knows that tefillin aren't square. So Rav Schechter said that you don't have to worry about it. Your eyes are like a precision instrument. We don't go by you. We go by the hamonam, and something which is normal, to something which a regular person sees, that's what we go by. And as well, we find that throughout. So it's not just limited to bugs that one has to see with their own eyes, but as well as whether it's the laws of tefillin, whether recognizing tefillin square, or even, you know, laws of need that we see, it's a klal, it's a rule throughout Shas. So what's the definition of a bug that I could see? So clearly invisible bugs, we eat all the time. Apparently they're not prohibited. The Torah only prohibits bugs that I could see. And we'll get into checking for bugs shortly. So what is considered, what's the definition of seeing a bug? So as we'll see, what happens if there's a black spot on a piece of lettuce? But to me it looks like dirt. I don't see any wings, I don't see any legs, I don't see a mouth, or whatever bugs have. So is that considered, if I can't see it's a bug, but I see something, is that considered that I see it or not? So Tosus and Erevin quotes in the Daf Chav Tes, quotes the Rashi that sheretz means sherat, something which is moving. So either if you have a black spot that's moving on your lettuce or some type of vegetable, so if it's moving, you know it's not dirt. Even though I can't make out the wings, if I could see it, if I could see it's a bug by looking at it, I could see the wings and legs and its usher. But, or if I see a black spot moving and I know dirt doesn't move by itself, so then I assume it's a animal. So, and in fact, that's what we'll have to, so that's what we'll get into a machlokas of Shlomo Zalman Orabach and the Chazanish in a moment. So we know there are three cities that won the lottery, so to speak. That the rule is, I think if it's a city, a town, more than 10,000 people, which is most of them, you have to get your water filtered. Again, this is in America, not Canada. You have to get your water filtered. However, there are three cities, for much of the reason, they don't get the water filtered. They put other tests, chemicals in the water. Again, the bugs are dangerous. The bugs are healthy to eat. It is not kosher. So the three cities are Boston, Seattle, and New York. And that was the whole issue that broke out a couple of years ago, that people said there are bugs in the water, and then copepods, and the question was, is that an issue or not? In other words, if you went to the reservoir and took out a bucket of water, you'd see swarming things. You couldn't tell they were bugs, they're tiny, but they were moving, so that's how you knew. So, however, let's say you take that water that had the bugs in, now you cook the water. So the bugs are dead. And the dead bugs aren't moving. So do I say now it's okay? So that's what the Darkei Tshuva, the Mumkacha quotes from many Achrona. No, that's the problem. If you took the water when they were moving, you knew they were bugs, now you cook it. The fact it's not moving now isn't going to help. It's like saying, well, I know there's, well, I'll put on a blindfold when I eat. I'm going to go eat my salad now. I'll put on blindfold, so as long as I don't see the bugs, it's okay. That doesn't work that way. So that, you know, that'd be a problem according to many poskim. The question is, let's say you don't know it's a bug. You never saw it when it was alive. And you see on a piece of lettuce, cabbage, whatever you want to make up, you see a black spot that is not moving. And yet, you didn't know. You don't know what it is. So the Rav Shlomo Zalman writes that he quotes the Tosfos, quotes Rashi, Sheret Sherat, if it's so small that you can't make it out that it's a bug and it's not moving, so therefore Sheret means Sherat, so therefore Rav Shlomo Zalman writes, one does not have to be concerned. Seeing a black spot is not enough of an issue. It's not considered nearby. It's not considered visible, and therefore one would not have to worry about it. However, at the end, he quotes, however, the Chazan Ish in his house would never eat such things. So the simple shot, it seems to be a dispute between Rav Shlomo Zalman Orabach and the Chazan Ish on whether one kid, if one just sees a black spot, they can't make out it's a bug, it's not moving. So I assume, is that considered seeing it? So Rav Shlomo Zalman says, no, it's not considered a bug that's prohibited because I can't see it. And he writes, however, in the house of the Chazan Ish, he won't eat it. So it seems to me that he's quoting out cover to the Chazan Ish, but my opinion is it's mutter. However, and that seems to be the pashtus, however, there are other later contemporary rabbanim or people put in the svarim that they say no, that Rav Shlomo Zalman backed down and he agreed with the Chazan Ish. So that's not so simple. It seems to be different interpretations, but the pashtus, it seems to be a machlokas of Shlomo Zalman versus the Chazan Ish on whether if there's a black spot and you don't know what it is and you can't make it out to be a bug and it's not moving, whether that's considered something which is visible. Rav Shlomo Zalman says no, hence it would be permitted. And the Chazon Ish would not eat it in his house. Well, he wouldn't eat it because he thought my Iker Hadin it's a problem, or because he was Machmir, it's not clear. But either way, what is clear is he wouldn't eat it in his house. So the question is, as we mentioned, that's the prohibition of eating bugs. It's prohibited to eat bugs which are visible. The question is, in other words, let's say we know there are bugs in different vegetables. So what is my obligation in terms of checking? Do I have a chiya bedika? Do I have an obligation to check for bugs? So we have a general rule. We go acharei rabim lahatos. We go by the majority. So in theory, whether we're checking for bugs in lettuce or whether we're checking for shatness in clothing, we go busser rov. And if 51% of the suits do not have shatness, or 51% of the vegetables you're checking for or eating don't have bugs, so min haTorah, biblically speaking, one would be permitted to eat it. So at what point, what percentage does one require to check? So min haTorah is completely permitted. Midrabanan, at what percentage? The rabbi said, if it's 51%, the rabbi said you have to check. But up until what point is there a chiyav bedika and not? So there's a famous Ramban in Chulin, where the Medrash talks about Adam HaRishon, not in the most flattering way, that me, when Adam HaRishon wakes up, who's going to go to this grave and open up his eyes, take the dirt off his eyes, because he didn't wait. He couldn't wait. He had to eat from the Eitz Hadas. We Jews wait for things. Shechita, we don't eat it right away. We go through a process. We're always waiting. That's why we wait at the Vilna Gaon. He waited after the Yom Tov of Pesach, and he made beer in Avdola to show you couldn't eat the beer. And the custom of a pregnant woman eating from the Esrog tree, so to speak, we have a tradition, one tradition, that the Esrog tree was in the Eitz Hadas. So to speak, if I was there, I went to eat. So the Medrash says Adam should have had more patience. And then the Ramban gives another example, Shechita. We don't eat it right away. We have to check if it's a trefa. We have to make sure the animal's kosher. We have to check different places. So the Ramban writes, the Medrash says you only check the sircha. You check for anything on the lungs. So the Ramban asks, what do you mean on the lungs? There's 70 different types of trefas. Why do you only check for the one on the lungs and not for the ones on everywhere else? So the Ramban writes, because all the other ones, it's not even a miyat hamatzah. Miyat hamatzah means literally miyat, a minority, matzoi, which are found. In other words, in terms of percentages, it's very small, but at least you make an appearance. Let's say, in Lashem Bnei Adam, let's say I asked someone once, so how many Jews do you think there are in Toronto? This is a person good with numbers. He was an accountant, non-Jewish. So we said, I know a couple of million. There aren't even 1 million, but, you know, maybe 200,000, 300,000. In Toronto. But if you go on Bathurst and Lawrence, they're a Miyat HaMatzah. You see a lot of them, so people think they're millions. But the Miyat HaMatzah is a Miyat, something which is much less than 50%, but it's still considered significant. So what is that amount? So the Ramban writes, The sirch, though, all the other ones that we don't have to worry about because it's very rare. But of course, if you see the animal sick and there's something wrong with it, then you got to check for other trafes. But a normal, average animal, you only have to check the lungs. So how much is... So what's the percentage of... So we could find out what is the percentage of trafe animals on the lungs, and we can figure out how much a mir hamatzah is. So the Mishnah, Yaakov, he goes with the standard 10%. He says, if it happens less than 10% of the time, so then you don't have to worry about it. Even midrabanan, there's no chiyav bedika. Min haTorah, it's mutter if you have more than 50%, but 51% chance, you still midrabanan says you still have to do a bedika. You have to check for bugs or shatness or whatever we're checking for. But less than 10%, I don't even have a chiyav bedika. And others say it's not 10%. Rav Salavechik, when he was the Rav in Boston, he used to be the Rav of the butcher shop, one of them in Boston, and he claims he used every kula in the book, every leniency in the book. And he said, and then some, and he still came out 14% of the times he found trephas on the lungs. So he says Amir HaMotzei was 14%, so anything less than, you want the number, the higher the number, the better, in terms of better meaning that anything under that number, you don't even have to do a bedika on. So according to the Rav, 14% was the Amir HaMotzei. If anything less than 14%, perhaps would not be a chayav and bedika. And the Rav used to make fun of the other butcher shop in town who claimed to be glatt kosher. He didn't even claim to be glatt kosher, he just claimed to be kosher. The other butcher shop claimed to be glatt kosher, and they had less than 10% of the time they found trafes. So the Rav didn't believe them, he called them, it was glatt trafe. He didn't think the other butcher shop was kosher. How could it be? They don't rely on any coolers, any leniencies. I take all the coolers and I still have 14%. So, but either way, and Rav Yashiv claims in Eretz Yisrael it's only 7%. That he says, do you have the statistics? He looked them up, and he claims so Amir HaMatzah in Eretz Yisrael will only be 7%. The Shmir Shabbos Kehuchasa, the author went to Argentina when he was younger, and he used to watch over Shlitas, and he said in Argentina, it's only 5% of the time. So he said maybe because the air is clean there, but he didn't want to say that's an exception to the rule. He didn't want to make be machmir that 5%, that anything, that the Amir HaMatzah is 5%. He said, and 7% is low, but so that's different opinions, anywhere between 7 and 14%. The Mishkan is Yaakov, he says 10%, that seems to be the standard. So, Min HaTorah, if it's more than 51%, you're allowed to wear the suit, you don't have to worry about chatness, you don't have to worry about bugs. Min HaMidrabanan, the rabbi said, you have to check, unless if it's less than Mir HaMatzoi, so if we say 10%, anything less than 10%, you wouldn't have to check on. Excuse me. So anything less than 10%, you wouldn't have to do a chiyav bedika. So, many suits. There's only one suit that I ever found that had shatness. That was a boss suit, and someone told me all boss suits have shatness. But generally speaking, most of the suits don't have. So obviously, if more than 50% don't have, you don't have a minatori, it's good. Midrabanan is a chiyav bedika. And it's less than 10%, it's not even a chiyav bedika. Our meaning is we check suits, we check all the suits, but certainly if it's less than 10, if it's less than a mir hamatzoi, and let's say you're in a bind and you have to wear a suit, you need it for the wedding or some other thing, so therefore you could rely on wearing the suit before bedika, since even midrabanan are not chayav to do a bedika, since we could assume that there's no shatness in the suits. So that's the chiyav bedika. The question is, let's say I have a vegetable, cabbage, lettuce, whatever, and there's a there's a 25% chance that there's bugs in here. So, midrabanan avachia, minat Torah, it's good. I don't really, it's kosher. But midrabanan, they said we have to do a bedika because it's a significant minority. It's above the 10% threshold, and therefore one bichayev to check. So you go through the washing procedure. So now what? So now let's say I wash it a bunch of times, and now, based on the procedure, I know there's only now I have the lettuce in front of me, and there's only a 5% chance now that there's bugs in it. So the question is, am I still chayev to do a bedika? Do I say since originally it started at 25%? So once it's a chiyah bedika, I have to do everything, have to make sure there's no bugs. Or is it just enough that I do the washing, that I get it under the 10%, and if I'm not mechuyav to do a bedika, and since I can't see the bugs, so therefore there's no issur. So we know there's something called bodek lettuce. That bodek is the word for the word bedika. It's a good name for lettuce. You have to check the lettuce. So they check it, it's under hashkacha. So the question is, are there any bugs in the bodek lettuce? So people think bodek lettuce, there's no bugs in it. Or not only that, or not only bodek lettuce, but say Rav Haynim in the Star K gives some hashkacha on some regular lettuce, I think the Dole, different brands, and the coleslaw, and it has a Star K. So people think, okay, there's no bugs in it. However, that's not necessarily true. So some people, that's not necessarily true, there aren't any bugs in it. And some people tell me the hashkach is only on the lettuce, not on the bugs, which doesn't make any sense. Then why would you won't need hashkacha, because lettuce is kosher. So what exactly is the pshat in that? So pshat is the bodek lettuce, what they do is, and probably the Star K, is they get it down to less than 10%. In other words, they do go through a washing period, because if you take, I think OU does many tests, they take this lettuce and they still find many bugs in it. So apparently, Rav Heidemann or the Bodeg, they do enough of a washing where it gets down to the less, and then they sell it, or they sell it or they put it out. So the question, are you obligated to do a bedika when you buy bodek lettuce, or when you buy any lettuce which has hashkacha on it? So in fact, I was once visiting someone, and the grandmother was sick, and the mother and the daughter were there, and it was close to Pesach, and the mother was saying, there's so much going on, it's Pesach, I'm just going to go buy bodek, I don't have time to go check the romaine for Pesach. And the daughter said, who just came back from seminary in England, in Gates, said, what are you talking about? You got to check bodek lettuce. So what's the machlokas between the granddaughter, the mother, and the daughter? What's the issue here? So there's a Mishnah in Baba Basra. The Mishnah says that basically the principle is, I'll just say it in my own words, that let's say you're buying or someone's selling you 100 pounds of apples, potatoes, whatever it is. So obviously if you get back 75% of a spoiled, you're going to send them back. But there's a certain amount, whether it's 1%, 2%, there's a certain amount, it's understood. If you find one spoiled apple or potato, it's understood that that's understood when you buy that much. So you can't get your money back. So let's say that it's a 2%. So the question is, whatever, someone sells someone, it's 50% spoiled. Okay, so the guy says, yeah, it's a mekach tos, it's a false CO, I need the rest of them. The guy says, okay, I'm not going to give you 50%, I'm only going to give you 48% because I could give you 2%. So the Mishnah says, no way, it doesn't work that way. Once you messed up, you have to pay him the full amount. So that's the halacha in Baba Basra. So I want to say same thing here. Once you have a chiya bedika, at 25%, the fact you get another 10%, you still got to do a chiya bedika. You got to get down to nothing, based on that Mishnah Baba Basra. Another poskim say no, because over there it's a din d'oraisa, it's a biblical din, whether it's a good sale. Here we're talking about a din d'rabanan. Min haTorah it's 100% permitted. It's only a din d'rabanan to a chiyah bedika. So what I argue on a din d'rabanan, there's room to be makel. One would not have to check if one bought the bodek lettuce or the other lettuce, even though it's a mere chain of months. So that's, you know, different. Speak to your local rabbi for your own sack or what the minig is in the town. So to summarize, we discussed some of the issues. We have to continue on this issue. But we discussed some of the issues of bugs. The issue is only if it's visible to the naked eye. We don't use precision instruments, as Ramosha wrote, by Nida, or Rav Shechter said about tefillin. And then we discussed the issues, the machlokas of Shlomo Zalman and Rav Chazon Ish on Tosfos Sheratz. A bug is on either that moves, black spots that are moving, or you can see it. What about a black spot that doesn't move? Do I assume that's considered? Is that considered an invisible bug, and it'd be okay to eat, or no? That's considered visible, and one would have to do a bedika and get rid of it. And the question, and in terms of at what point do you do chiyah bedika, the different shitas, the Mishkanos Yaakov 10%, we have Rav Salvation 14%, Rav Yosef 7, etc. So we'll have to continue with this inyan next time.